Hello everyone, this is Dr. Swati Mishra from International School of Business Management at Suresh Gyan Vihar University, Delhi. And we will be continuing with our further sessions of project management. As I have been constantly reinforcing the importance of project management for every manager who aspires to work in big firms in future, and take up good and big projects in future, project management becomes a key essential course to be studied by all the aspiring managers of future. And that is why Suresh Gyan Vihar University has come up with these e-learning materials of project management, specially designed for the BBA and MBA students who want to be future entrepreneurs also and get associated with big firms as their employees also. So if you want to work in some big projects tomorrow, please get geared up today itself. In our previous sessions, we have been discussing the project feasibility, how to judge or analyze whether any project idea that you have come up with is feasible enough or not. And we have discussed a couple of things wherein we discussed as to what makes a project very feasible to be, you know, started working upon. So there were a couple of important aspects that are supposed to be studied, and we started discussing them one by one. We discussed the economic analysis, we discussed what is technical analysis, organizational analysis. Today, we will be taking up a very important part of that analysis, which is financial and economic feasibility analysis of any project. So, what is this financial and economic feasibility analysis? That is something which you have to understand thoroughly. Say, whenever we consider working upon any project, it is very obvious that the first and the foremost thing that we do is to analyze its financial viability. And what makes a project financially viable? You know, every organization has its budgets set, right? And those budgets are, you know, drawn from the finances of an organization, and only a limited amount of capital can be invested by the organization in any project. Considering the importance of the project and considering the success ratio or success expectancy of the project. So, you know, every organization, when makes the decision of investing any amount in any project, it looks at the financial viability of the project, how much of finance is required to actually be, you know, to implement that project, and how can we understand whether the project is going to, you know, return the investments, we're going to bring in some return on the investments that have been done. So any organization will become interested in investing in that project only if it finds that, yes, the first of all, the project's finances lie within the permissible limits of any organization, which means that an organization has the capacity, or the sponsor has the capacity, to invest in that project. And secondly, you know, in future, either the revenue that is going to be generated from the project are going to be the, you know, proved to be real returns on investments that have been done, or the benefits that the project is going to bring to the society are, you know, so huge that the project cannot be avoided. So there has to be either of the two things to make the project, you know, financially very attractive for any sponsor or an organization which plans to invest in that project. So that is what is actually meant by financial feasibility analysis. So whenever an organization decides upon conducting this financial analysis, a few points are jotted down in front of you, which are supposed to be taken into account by the organization when it plans to start up the financial analysis. So the financial aspects of project preparation and analysis include the financial effects of a proposed project on each of its various participants. In agricultural projects, the participants include, farmers, private sector firms, any kind of public corporations who are interested in making those investments, sometimes the project agencies, and perhaps the national treasury also. Because, in many agricultural projects, even the government is interested in making investments, considering the fact that, especially in a country like India, India is mainly the main occupation of the country is agriculture, and there is ample of agricultural land which is available, and a huge amount of population is actually doing farming as their main occupation. So government is also interested in making investments in some good projects of projects which will bring betterment in the area of agriculture. And it has been seen in almost all the 5-year plans of the government also that they have been investing in agricultural projects a lot. They have separate budgets which are set for them. And that was what actually helped us bring in green revolution in the country, like drip irrigation systems, canals, water canals, tube wells, investments on biotechnology research. All these could be considered as projects. So, if I come up with a project idea and I am promising that, with the new canal system, the deeper and drought-prone villages of Rajasthan are going to get good water supply even at the time of droughts, then that would be called an agricultural project. Now, how do you conduct the financial analysis of? You find out how much of investment is required in that project from the sponsor. Now, that sponsoring body could be anybody, any private agency, government agency, state government itself. But initially, it is found out as to how much of investment is required. And after that investment, how much of benefit will be lured by the farmers through that project on which the government is making investment, whether the production of agricultural products is going to increase or not. And if it is found that no, it is this project is going to prove to be highly beneficial to the agricultural people from the agricultural background, the farmers, then it might be considered that yes, we can go for that project. So, one of the major objectives of the financial analysis of farms is actually to judge how much farm families who are participating in the project will have to live on. And once the project is completed, how many families are actually going to get benefited from it? So, there are a number of things which have to be evaluated under this financial analysis. And unless a correct financial analysis or accurate financial analysis is carried out, you cannot actually reach to the conclusion whether the project is going to prove to be financially benefiting or not. So whenever we are carrying out financial analysis, obviously there are multiple good financial analysts of different organizations who carry out these analysis, and the analyst will actually need budget projections that I really hope that you all know what are budget projections. These budget projections are actually the estimates maintained year after year of the future gross receipts and expenditures, which means that, you know, how much of profit anyone is going to make and how many expenditures one is to incur. On the basis of that, an estimate is made. So this should include the cost associated with the production and of course the credit repayments by the farm families which the farm families must make to determine what remains to compensate the family for its labor, management skills and capital also. So the analysis of this farm income will also permit assessment of incentives for the farmers who are participating in the project of that canal system. What will be the probable change in the farm income? What will be the timing when this change will come? Which means that if the change is going to come after 3 years, maybe, then for 3 years, how will they survive? How will the population survive without it? So then after that, you know, you also have to analyze how likely are price changes or fluctuations that would affect the income of the population and of course the project also. Sometimes what happens is that a financial analysis is done. You also have to keep in mind that how much of, you know, price hike of the, you know, equipments or the supply material that is required in the project will be, you know, occurring. So once you've estimated the amount of price hike that is going to occur, you can actually analyze that, you know, whether the project is going to remain within the limits or not, within the budgetary limits of the sponsor or not. And, you know, also one has to find out that what will be the effect of the subsidies arrangements on any kind of project. What changes, you know, the government policy might affect the income earned by the people around or the farmers also for the case that I have taken here. Will the new subsidies be needed to provide sufficient incentives for the project to proceed also? So, you know, all these considerations have to be taken into account by the analyst. So, an analysis of the financial aspect of the project administration will also be needed here. And the questions that one should ask at this time will include questions like, you know, what the investment funds will the project need and when, first of all. Obviously, you know, you have to be clear about the funds that will be required by the project in total and, of course, in breakup form also, like time to time, how much of fund will be required in the project, so that the sponsor can be ready with the, you know, disposable funds at the time when their requirement will arise. If such type of breakdown structure is not created, a work breakdown structure along with its budgetary needs is not created, and then, you know, obviously you need analysis for this also. And if these breakdowns are not created, then sometimes it happens that, you know, at some particular step of the project or at some particular stage of the project, the project has to come to a sudden halt because of the stoppage of funds released by the sponsors, because maybe they were not even ready with the funds, because they did not expect that requirement to arise at that point of time. Then, of course, the next question that one must ask is that what will be the operating expenses when the project is underway? Sometimes, you know, it happens that whatever budgets you have created and whatever actual requirements occur when the project is going on, they are different. So that is why, you know, to understand this properly and to not have any kind of hassles later on, it is highly important to estimate that, you know, what kind of operating expenses will occur later on while the project is underway. You also have to find out whether, you know, these expenses depend on budget allocations, or will the project produce sufficient revenue to cover for its administration costs. And of course, there must be a clear evidence that the project will have a net gain if it has to be a feasible one, right? Which means that, you know, there should be a clear-cut outline of the project, that this is going to be the time duration when the project will be complete, and these are going to be the benefits that the project is going to lure out after its completion. These are going to be the net gains from the project, and these outlines are actually, or these highlights are going to actually prove to be a clear evidence that the project will be project is a feasible option. So all the initial project costs as well as the operation costs which are going to occur in future or are occurring while the project is underway, all of them have to be clearly understood and worked upon so that they can be easily incurred also and easily covered up also in future when the project starts generating revenue. So I really hope that, you know, this financial analysis part is clear to all of the viewers. If there is any doubt, you're most welcome to leave your doubts and queries in the message box. I would be really happy to answer to them. And after this is the first part of the session in which we have covered the financial feasibility analysis. And now we are moving ahead towards the economic feasibility analysis. So I have discussed with you economic feasibility analysis 2 sessions back. I'd explained what is economic analysis. We will just discuss it into further details in this session. So whenever we talk about economic analysis is basically concerned with a few important aspects, and those aspects could be summarized as, you know, first of all, how to identify the effects of a proposed project to the society, which means that whatever effects the project is having on the society, you know, one needs to identify them properly. The second is quantification of the effects of the proposed project, which means that, you know, whatever effects the project is going to show at the end or post its completion, you have to create some measurable indices through which you can actually quantify the ratio of the success or the success rate of the project. And finally, declare whether the project was successful or not. So for that matter, this type of quantification is highly necessary. Then, of course, the pricing of the costs and the benefits to reflect their values to the society should be set accurately, which means that now that you've quantified your cost, you know the effect of the proposed project to the society, now comes the time to price your project or the outcomes of your project. So in economic analysis, you know, shadow prices are used, while in financial analysis, the market prices are used. So please get it thoroughly understood that shadow prices will be used while in economic analysis, while in financial analysis, market prices are used. So when we talk about this economic analysis, we have to understand the fact that, you know, the economic aspects of project preparation and analysis require, you know, a lot of determination of the likelihood that a proposed project will contribute significantly to the development of the total economy, and that its contribution will be big enough to justify using the scarce national resources it will need, like, for example, any kind of fuel or maybe wood or anything like that which belongs to the nature. If that is required by the project, right, you also have to find out that, you know, how the project is going to contribute to the society as a whole and how significant that contribution is going to prove to be. If the contribution is found to be highly significant, then you may actually consider working upon that project. But if you find out that, you know, although the project is requiring a lot of scarce natural resources and we are dissipating huge funds in the project, but the project is not proving to be that significant contributor to the benefit of the society or the development of the society, then you can actually reconsider your decision of, you know, running that project or working upon that project. So that is why the point of view which is acquired by economic analysis is always that of the society as a whole and not one individual who is actually trying to do the analysis. So now we will discuss and move further ahead. Now that we have discussed both financial and economic analysis and we have understood as to what these financial and economic analysis actually mean, you know, we also, I mean, all the viewers must have by now understood that, you know, the financial and the economic analysis are very complementary to each other. The financial analysis takes the viewpoint of the individual participants, whereas the economic analysis takes the viewpoint of the society as a whole. So, you know, however, because the same discounted cash flow measures are used in financial analysis also to estimate the returns to a project participant, and in the economic analysis to estimate the returns to the society also. So, you know, the confusion between the two analyses always arises. But there are three important distinctions between the two analysis approaches, which each one of you should understand clearly. So one should not get confused between financial analysis and the economic analysis. So let us try to discuss as to what these, three distinctions are. First of all, in economic analysis, taxes and subsidies are treated as transfer payments, that which means that the new income which is generated by a project includes taxes, and the project can bear during production and any kind of sales tax buyers who are willing to pay when they purchase the project's products. So that is what is economic analysis, right? Economic consideration. So these taxes, which are a part of the total project benefit, are transferred to the government, which acts on behalf of the society as a whole and are not treated as a cost. So I hope you have understood that what exactly is meant by this economic part. So now if we go contradictory to this, so conversely, a government subsidy to the project is basically a cost to the society, since the subsidy is an expenditure of resources that the economy incurs to prepare the project, right? So there have been multiple cases in which, the sponsors start feeling that the, project is making us invest a lot of money, and we are yet not clear whether it is going to be revenue generator for the organization or not. And if the revenue that is going to get generated is not as huge an amount, then the sponsoring body will get confused about that economic analysis that has been done by for them. So in financial analysis, such adjustments are normally unnecessary, since the taxes are usually treated as a cost and subsidies as a return. Similarly, in financial analysis, the market prices are normally used, right, to make that analysis. So these actually take into account the taxes and subsidies, and from these market prices comes the data used in the economic analysis. So in economic analysis, however, some market prices may be changed so that they more accurately may be used to reflect the social or economic values. And of course, these adjusted prices are called as shadow or else accounting prices. So with this, we are moving to the last part of discussion for today's session. I was differentiating the economic analysis with the financial analysis. I have explained key differences of financial analysis as compared to economic analysis. And now we will just talk a little bit more about economic analysis, and then we will close down this session. So in case of this economic analysis, the interest on the per capita is never separated and deducted from the gross return, because it is a part of the total return to the capital available to the society as a whole. And additionally, it is the total return including interest that the economic analysis is designed to estimate. In fact, financial analysis, interest paid to external suppliers of money may be you know, actually deducted to derive the benefit stream available to the owners of the capital. But the interest paid to the entity from whose point of view the financial analysis is being done is treated as a cost. So because the interest is part of the total return to the equity capital, which is contributed by the entity, and hence it is a part of the financial return of the entity receivers. So with that, we have reached to an end of today's session. We have discussed more or less almost all the parts of feasibility analysis, except one more small part that I want to discuss with you, which is social and environmental analysis. So what is this, you know, social analysis? Under social analysis, we have mentioned that projects should consider the social patterns and practices of the clientele the project is going to serve. So more frequent project analysis are, you know, expected to be examined more carefully, and the broader social implications of the proposed investments also, and social consideration should be carefully considered to determine which is a proposed project and whether that proposed project is responsive to the national objectives or not. So for example, the case of creating employment opportunities and also issues that are dealing with the, you know, income distribution within the society. For social reasons, when the governments know what to emphasize on, like maybe growth in a particular region, they would exactly know, you know, what would encourage the person to land up into his favorite place. So for social reasons, when government know what to emphasize on growth in particular regions, they would encourage the projects that can be implemented in these areas, right? And they can actually find out that, you know, what are the social implications in any particular area and how we can actually curb those social problems. And then comes your financial environmental analysis, like, you know, whatever pollution is occurring due to any project, any kind of environmental degradation like soil erosion or landslide or maybe any other calamity, like if you are reducing the groundwater level and a dark zone is getting created, like our university is in Jaipur. And there is this area called Jagatpura in Jaipur, where there are lots of multi-story heights that have been developed by the constructors without giving it a thought that the groundwater level, due to boring purposes, will reduce to such a level that, point number one, that you won't be able to draw any water from it. And point number two is that because, you know, the buildings have the surroundings totally made up of concrete and all, so, you know, the seepage of rainwater through the mud does not take place, and that is why the groundwater level does not increase. And slowly there will a day will come that, you know, all the groundwater will become zero, and dark zones are going to get created under these multi-story heights. So that is why, you know, to curb down any problem related to environment, you know, environmental feasible analysis is highly required. Because say if you come up with a new project and you go and try to buy some land in the outskirts of the area, But that land is then connected to the forest area of that city. And you start your project by cutting down the trees, and then suddenly some environmental agencies will come and they will bring a stay on your project, which will claim that you cannot start working on your project till you get the court's approval. And you all know, you know, how much of time and paperwork and documentation all that will take. So with this, we have almost come to an end of this session. I really hope that this session was thoroughly informative for all the viewers. If you have any queries in your mind regarding this session, please leave your comments in the message box. I would be really happy to answer to them. In fact, if you require any kind of teaching learning material, do ping us. We'll definitely share whatever we have with us with you people. So that is all from my side for today. I really hope that the session was thoroughly informative for you and a lot of new things you must have learned. So that is all from my side for today. This is Dr. Swati Mishra from International School of Business Management at Suresh Gyanvihar University, Jaipur, signing off. Thank you so much and have a nice day. Bye-bye.